So welcome all to this virtual SIB Computational Biology Seminar Series. Today we have the pleasure to have Bastien Chopard from the University of Geneva, and in particular from the Scientific and Parallel Computing Group. Bastien got a PhD in theoretical physics from the University of Geneva in 88, and then he spent 2 years at the MIT in the United States and a year at the Supercomputing Center in Jülich in Germany as a postdoc. He's now a full professor at the Computer Science Department at the University of Geneva, and is also a group leader at the SIB, Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics. So briefly, the Scientific and Parallel Computing Group develops new algorithms and methods to better understand and or predict various complex phenomena in biology. The group focuses on multi-scale modeling and computing, high-performance computing, cellular automata, lattice Boltzmann methods, and multi-agent systems, as well as optimizing technique and machine learning. Today, Bastien will share with us some of his numerical modeling and simulation in order to better understand thrombus formation in cerebral aneurysms. Thank you, Bastien, for accepting this invitation, and the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Diana, for the invitation. So I'm very happy to be here, and thank you for attending this presentation. So today I'd like to talk about thrombosis in cerebral aneurysm. So for me, it's a field which started more than 10 years ago with a colleague, a neuroradiologist at the Hospital of Geneva, who came to me and said, oh, by the way, could you simulate the blood in a cerebral aneurysm? It's very important to understand the efficiency of new devices. And I say, okay, no idea, let's try. So we did some work, and then we started to say, okay, but we can simulate something, but do we really understand what's going on, and do we understand what's the effect of these devices? And then it started a long research, which actually ended up through a European project, where hopefully we could clarify something which is very critical in medicine, but also with an important question in biology. So I'd like to start to discuss a bit more about my modeling and simulation techniques, because that's the core of what we do. And after that, of course, I will show how we apply this to the problem of understanding what happened in cerebral aneurysm. And as I mentioned, this work has been done by a European consortium under the acronym Thrombus. For those who are interested, you can find more information there. The project has ended now 2 years ago, or 1.5 year ago. So you might be all convinced, but for me, it's been clear for many years that numerical modeling and simulation, it's become more and more critical to address challenging problems in science, but also very much in life science, where maybe these techniques are less used than maybe physics, chemistry. But also something which is important to tell is that the standard mathematical approach, which is to use a differential equation or some equation that you have to solve, may not be so easy to apply in many life science problems. So therefore, there are another way to proceed, which is try to copy nature at a lower level, like what people call particle-based model. We'll see some example of cell-based model or rule-based model, where you're not solving equation, but basically you try to reproduce the physical processes directly in an abstract way in your computer. And that's actually a very powerful way to address many, many problems. And it works well because if you're interested in a global question of your system, the detail of the microscopic interaction may be not critical, provided that you are correct with some essential ingredient. So the idea is that we want to create in the computer, say, an in silico universe in which you can reproduce your biophysical processes. And of course, the art of this thing is to capture the essential feature of the system you want to model. So I want just to illustrate this with this slide. On the upper line, you see a differential equation, which is what most people use when they want to solve a fluid equation. So they want to know how a fluid flows. So u is the speed of the fluid, p is the pressure, this is the viscous term, and this is very difficult partial differential equation, actually. What I'd like to stress here is that the steps you have to go through from the phenomena to the solution is basically these four steps. So from the phenomena, you have to build this PDE, this mathematical formulation. Then, unfortunately, this equation is most of the time you cannot solve it analytically, so you have to solve it numerically, and for this you also have to apply smart algorithms for discretizing it, and finally you have the computer solution. You should also understand that the step from phenomena to PDEs took several hundred of years before people at the mathematical level to go to this type of construction. So, of course, this is done now and we can use it and we should use it, but this is by no way trivial at this point. Huh? Now we have actually another tool, which is powerful computers, and we can rethink the way to model a natural phenomena. So this is a fluid, basically, okay? But the fluid, we know it's particles. It's like fluid particles that move in the space, collide, interact, and so on. So why don't we try to take this picture directly in the computer? So we'll do an abstraction of the fluid movement on a simplified space. Here it's a 2D lattice, but of course you can do that in 3D. But you see these little arrows here, they represent some fluid element that move either to the left, the right, or diagonally. And sometimes they can collide at the same point, meaning that they basically interact. That's what we call a collision, or it's a physical interaction. And the result is that all these fluid elements, they are redistributed in the space with different velocity, like a BR ball that collide. And then they move to other points in space where they will certainly meet other particles and continue to interact. So that's a very, actually, correct physical picture of what a fluid is. What is critical in this process of collision is that the amount of mass you have here is the same here, so you don't lose mass, and you have the same momentum, okay, also. And that's the important physical feature that you should keep in your simplified dynamical process. It's well known that actually this equation, Navier-Stokes equation, is just a mathematical expression of momentum conservation. Okay, so actually there is not much more in one or the other. The thing is that here you go directly from the phenomena to the computer model and the solution. So what is sketched in this little diagram is what people call the Lattice-Boltzmann method. It's of course a bit more complicated than that, but essentially if you know how to explain or express this collision term, if you know how to generalize in 3D, and if you know to put boundary condition, you have a fluid model. And that's what we have been developing for several years at the University of Geneva, in particular Dr. Jonas Latt, who is the father of all this development, is this Palabos software, which is parallel Lattice-Boltzmann software. It's an open source software where you have extremely powerful simulation possibility for different type of system. So I'd like to illustrate a few. So sorry if the movie will cause some problem because we couldn't have them very smoothly, but yeah. So this is a simulation done with this Lattice-Boltzmann method, a bit more than just my little diagram, I must confess. But this simulates actually very precisely the way you drain the dam in Verbois in Geneva. Another example of this method is illustrated on this figure, which hopefully will start. And you can see you can generate extremely complex flows, even though it's a very simple, low-level dynamical process. Okay, maybe you may have fun also to see how a washing machine works. So you can compare, you know, the US type of washing machine where it's vertical to the one in Europe where it perhaps horizontal and see which one is cleaning better, this type of things. Okay. But I mean, here we are more in a bio-oriented seminar, so I'd like also to show you this example, which is another example done with the lattice Boltzmann method through the company that Jonas Latt created, Flowkit, as a consultant for Palabos. And this is an example where you have a broken vertebra, and the way to repair a broken vertebra is to inject some cement into it. But of course, you want to know the exact amount of cement you want to inject. Otherwise, it can overflow and block the vertebra. So here is an example where you can get a very complicated geometry by medical imaging, and you can use Palabos to simulate the injection of the cement and to see exactly how many cement the doctor should inject. And this is, of course, an important question. As you may guess, this simulation I just showed, they are not, easy to do, and they might not fit on this laptop. They may require a lot of computing power, and in particular, parallel computing and high-performance computing. I mean, like from 100 to 1,000 of tightly coupled processor actually collaborating to the computation. So where could we find this type of resources? I guess in many institutions you have them. For example, in Geneva, we have a machine with 2,000 cores that can be connected and used for the same application. But you probably know that at the Manic area, we have CADMOS, which is a center for advanced modeling science, where we have a machine here, a powerful machine with 16,000 nodes, which is actually accessible for researchers from University of Geneva, University of Lausanne, and EPFL equally. And at a higher scale, you have, of course, the Swiss Center for Scientific Computing in Lugano, which now owns the fastest machine in Europe. Okay, so we have access to powerful resources here. just to make a little bit more clear what it means to parallelize, and since I'm going to talk about aneurysm, I'm going to use this example. So here you have a geometry of an artery with this aneurysm, which is this deformation, and you want to compute the blood flow inside that, and you want to use a parallel computer because you have you need a very thin resolution and do that in a pulsatile regime. So basically, you cover this geometry with little cubes like that. And for each cube, you solve the fluid equation that I showed you with the lattice Boltzmann. And of course, between two cubes, you have interaction because one particle can go from one cube to the next. So all these cubes, basically, they are like computing power and interacting continuously every millisecond or million of second with the neighboring site. So it's of course mean that you need to reprogram code, have the proper data structure. But on the picture you have here, you can maybe see that you actually gain a lot of speed. For instance, you can compare a situation where you have 128 processors, and you can go up to 16,000 processors, and basically you gain exactly the factor of the number of processors you add. So it means that your application or your way of parallelizing scales very well, and you actually use well all the processor you put in this computation, which is not granted depending on the application. Okay, maybe a few more examples of application we've been working on. For instance, with my colleague in the Hospital of Charleroi and Université Libre de Bruxelles, we're interested to understand if we can find the adhesion rate and aggregation rate of platelets on the blood vessel, for instance. So there are experiments that can be done, and basically you see here the result of the experiment. So each of these little cluster is number of platelet aggregated. So this image is 1 millimeter, 1 by millimeter. And then the question So if I want to extract from this picture the adhesion rate or the aggregation rate, how can I do that? I mean, it's not written in this picture, so you have to think of a model which reproduces all the process. And it turns out actually that if you try to do that, you realize that the current knowledge about the way platelets move and adhere and deposit is not enough to explain this image. So basically, it forces you to explore more. And finally, well, we did that with new experiment, new clinical, new in vitro experiment, and we end up with a numerical model, which I have no time to explain here, but you can see a very good agreement now between this experiment and simulation. Another example of a simulation we're working, which is what we can call a cell-based tissue model. It's within the epiphysics project in the SystemX initiative. So the idea is to represent all the cells as a computer entities, and it interacts with the neighboring cells according to some elasticity property and whatever. So we are interested in several things. So here you have an example of simply such a tissue which can grow, so cells can divide, and they are actually subject maybe to some physical constraint, like they grow into a constrained environment. And so you can simulate this type of things. Here you have another example where you try to understand how the dermal papilla of a hare on a spiny mouse developed in competition with the other cell around them, and it's a sort of competition of two type of cells which can be addressed, and it works rather well. Okay, so let's back to the main part of my talk, which is what is a cerebral aneurysm. I already show you a picture, but this is a real medical image where you see this deformation here, that it's not so frequent, and even if you have one, it's not clear that it will rupture. The problem is that if it ruptures, it's extremely serious, and most of the patients who have a rupture, they have a permanent damage. So then the doctor really would like to know if it will break or how to treat them. So what is still unclear now is we don't know exactly why it appears. And we don't know why it ruptures. Okay, so there were previous projects that tried to solve this, but I don't think it's solved yet. So we decided to address a different question, is how can it be treated? So suppose the doctor decide to treat it. What's the best way? Can we give some recommendation? So the key point is that what drives the evolution of the aneurysm is the interaction between the flow of the blood and the vessel wall. Okay, so there's biophysical constraint. So what people have understood from a long time ago, the clinician, is that they have to reduce the flow inside the aneurysm. And first, they were using clips, more recently coils, which is much less invasive because clip, you have to open the skull, and that's really a very major operation. Coils are less invasive. So basically, you insert inside the aneurysm some coil of metal, which slow down the flow. And more recently, flow diverter. And if you do it well, you see on this angiogram that after the treatment, there's no more motion of blood in the aneurysm. And this opens the door to remodeling because there's a thrombus formation in there. So we were specifically interested in the thrombus project to understand how flow diverter works. So flow diverter, you can see them here in more detail. It's a tubular mesh, okay, made of very thin wires that are, you know, braided in a smart way. So that's what the company do and may not tell you exactly how they do, because they think that part of the secret is to have a proper braiding of these wires. And basically the rule is that you try to rebuild the main vessel with this tube. But of course you cannot make something which is totally impermeable, because then you will cut all the exchange of blood with this cavity, and then you make even worse. So you have to just reduce the flow but still keep the exchange of oxygen and all the good molecule that will help the remodeling. The thing is that this treatment has been quite successful, but it still fails to work in 20% of the patient, and clinicians don't really know why. So this definitely something to understand. And actually, it turns out that nobody really understands the detail of what happens there and what makes this part of the aneurysm clot and then remodel. So the goal of Trombus was to combine biological knowledge and new in vitro experiment with clinical observation on the cohort of patients and numerical modeling to see if we can get a better understanding of the process, which again was known empirically to work, but without a clear understanding of how. So this is an example of an aneurysm from a patient, which has been segmented by all kind of techniques of image segmentation, and that's the colleague from Lyon who did that. And here you see that all this part is the part that clotted in the aneurysm, and this part here is what's called the lumen, so that's where the blood is still flowing. So this is actually very good for the patient to go from this to this, and the idea is to produce this by inserting a flow diverter in this to help nature to do that. So in terms of numerical modeling, you have to realize that it's a challenge, which I tried to illustrate on this little diagram. So this diagram show you the spatial scale at which the phenomena take place and the time scale at which they take place and the main processes that are involved. So you have the blood flow in the artery, which basically range from millimeters to centimeters, that's the size of an artery, okay? And it's basically a time scale of 1 second, which is at most the heartbeat, okay? So it's a rather fast process. On the other hand, the clot, which is on the same spatial scale because it occupied the vessel, it develops between, I would say, hours to days, even weeks. And all this is actually triggered by the molecules in the blood, like platelet and red blood cells, plus other molecules that I will mention, which are more the order of the microns. So if you'd like to put all this in a numerical simulation, it's an extremely big challenge. And so far, we are not able to do that. So we have to find tricks to try to address this kind of problem. And one trick is maybe to say, OK, we try just to concentrate. We forget about the a detailed simulation of red blood cells and platelet and all this. We just consider that at a macroscopic level. And basically, it means that you put all the process here at this stage here, and that gives you something which is macroscopic. The other approach to say, no, I want to see more in detail the thing, and that's a simulation where explicitly you model all your red blood cell platelet. And that's a bit more difficult. But it's not a bad idea, because if you look at simulation, which here are 2D, you can see that the spatial distribution of platelet and red blood cell is definitely not homogeneous in space. So it means that you expect that a simple flow simulation might not capture everything. You see that there's a zone where you have a big accumulation of particles, and other where there are less. So it means that very likely we have to take care of that. But so far, we cannot do this at a scale of a real patient, for time scale of a real patient. So then we came back with some more macroscopic simulation, which is already a challenge, because you should realize that this flow diverter, if you want to take the real size, these struts, these little wires, they have typically a size of, let's say, 20 microns. Okay, so you have to resolve all these little wires, and here this is typically of the order of centimeters, and you have to do that at rather high flow condition, and you see it can take up to 10 days on 120 processor for only two heartbeats. So this is illustrated in this movie, which hopefully I'll show you. So you see here the detail of one heartbeat, and actually there will be two heartbeats. And here you see particles which are just tracing the flow. You see that clearly this flow diverter helped reducing the flow here, not completely, but clearly it's less than what you have in the main artery. So is it sufficient to produce clot or not? That's a question we have, of course, to investigate. But remember that it already takes 10 days on 100 processors just to do two heartbeats. So it's and it's not even resolving the red blood cells or whatever. Okay. So here you can anyway compare for a given patient what's the shear rate. Because I will come back to this in a moment, but we believe that the shear rate at the wall is the key for producing the thrombus. So you can see how the shear rate changes with and without the placement of a flow diverter. So the red and the blue correspond to presence and absence of a flow diverter. So in most of these points here, you see that placing a flow diverter reduces considerably the shear rate, except in a very particle point, which I think is this P5, where there's some pathological geometrical feature, which makes actually the flow diverter is locally increasing the wall shear stress. But globally, it's decreasing, which is exactly what you would like to happen. So those are, of course, patients that have been collected during the thrombus project by a neuroradiologue from Montpellier. Okay, so if you do the analysis of many patients, you observe something which is very interesting and goes into this validation of this hypothesis, that here you see that you have aneurysm that spontaneously thrombose and those that did not. Those that spontaneously thrombose and those that do not. Okay, and here you have the value of the shear stress at the wall. And you see that you have a very nice line separating these two experiments. So it's really support the hypothesis that if the shear rate is low enough, so below about 30 second minus one, then you can promote this thrombus. If it's higher, it's not going to happen. So basically, it means that for a doctor, he should place a stent which makes sure that we are below this value. Okay. So that's a result of this thrombus project, which already I think is an important result. Of course, you can play the game of saying now that I start understanding a bit what's the criteria, I can play with the optimization of the stent design. That's something that I've been doing with colleagues in Japan, where we are using optimization techniques to change the design of a stent to find the most efficient one with a given porosity. So it's not always easy to build, of course, and that's, of course, a constraint, but here it's more to demonstrate the possibility of doing it. So now we would like really to have a full model of thrombus formation, which of course is based on this observation that at low shear rate you start something. And it will be an extension of a very simple model we started in 2005 with this team in Geneva, where we had a 2D model, which was already explaining that basically the thrombus can just form partially in the aneurysm or completely fill it, or sometime, which is very bad for the patient, start invading the apparent vessel, and then that, of course, may block the artery. So that was already a success that we could explain all this observation by a very simple numerical model. So within thrombus, we had a biologist who could do experiment, and we did an extensive study, and basically we decided that what looks the most likely to happen is the following set of process, and maybe it looks obvious for you, but it's not written in literature. I mean, there's a coagulation cascade which are well known, but they are much too complex to be implemented, so you have really to understand what are dominant. The idea, and that's validated by experimental observation, that endothelial cells, when subject to low shear rate, they produce some tissue factor, and this tissue factor produce thrombin. Okay, so basically an endothelial wall where the shear rate is too low starts producing procoagulant material. Then you have fibrinogen and antithrombin, which are always present in your blood, they are always created, and if thrombin and fibrinogen meet, Okay, they react together, they form a fibrin, and that's the start of the clot. Okay, so if you want to make the clot, you should make sure that you have somewhere in your system thrombin has been produced, and when this thrombin interact with the fibrinogen brought by the blood, it creates the clot. Okay, but on the other hand, there's also antithrombin, which is brought by the blood, which try to kill this thrombin. So there's a competition here to try to reduce that. Okay, and then there's a few other processes that I maybe don't want to go too much into the detail now, but you can really translate all this into a computer model in terms of kind of advection, reaction, diffusion processes, so where all these letters, they correspond to some particle that can interact in the same place. So if you do that, you start having a model where you can produce the thrombus. And here you have an example of what may happen with parameters that may not be realistic, but at least can show what may happen. So here you have the blood flowing, and all this black region is the fibrin that keep adding on the cavity of the aneurysm, which is exactly what you want. It's also interesting in this example to realize that if you don't take a pulsatile flow, as some people doing model do, because of course it's much simpler to implement, you would find something extremely different. Okay, that's the exact same model, but with different flow condition, and you see that the clot is forming where it shouldn't form in the parent artery. Okay, so really working with correct flow condition is essential if you want to do that. Okay, and now, of course, the question is, can we predict in a patient what happens? So we had within the thrombus project some images of patients with a giant aneurysm like this one that at some point in their evolution spontaneously clot, and the question is whether we can reproduce the pattern or the volume that was clotted. So here I must stress that it's also a challenge in terms of simulation. I already mentioned this multi-scale aspect. The clot in a real patient may take weeks to months. Okay, it's not completely clear, but in the simulation you cannot wait that long. I mean, you see how long it is already to simulate one heartbeat. So here we try to make acceleration to have the full clot happening on 2000 heart cycle. Of course, so it means that we actually increase the reaction rate of this reaction I showed you before. Huh? So that's the way we can speed up the process. But if you do that, actually you observe that if you compare the lumen of the patient, so this is the lumen which is left, and that's where the clot took place, and the corresponding simulation, you see a very good agreement. Okay, so it means that we can really reproduce observation with this model. And here you have a second case where you can see the aneurysm of the patient. Also the clot in red, which has been spontaneously produced at some stage in the evolution of the aneurysm of the patient. And the blue, which is what the model produced. Of course, it's not exactly the same because there are a lot of things that we don't know. It's, of course, several parameters are patient-specific. The blood composition, all this, so it's not taken into account in our system. So we really have a model which give a generic behavior, but you see that it's already quite good and promising. So in conclusion, I think this numerical simulation that and modeling I've illustrated, which implements basic law of physics and basic law of biology. So again, we try to start with the fundamental processes, and we put all the elements into a given space over time, and then we can produce virtual experiment, you know, in silico experiment of blood clotting, and that gives you that explains scenarios, or you can test scenarios. And actually, we were the first to propose a thrombosis model in cerebral aneurysm that match clinical observation. And in addition to this, we could really understand that all the phenomena are actually due to the spatio-temporal interaction between the particles. So it means that if you want to produce clot, you have to have at the same times, at the same position, thrombin and fibrin. But at some point, thrombin can be exhausted because it reacts or it's annihilated by antithrombin. And so it means that you can explain rather easily a process that has been observed for a long time by a clinician but not explained, is why suddenly things start, why it keep growing for a while, and why it suddenly stops. So it's just spatial and temporal interaction between particles transported by blood in a geometry that may vary over time. So it's, of course, complicated to predict analytically, but numerically, of course, you can do that. And in the end, of course, what you would like to provide a medical doctor with a tool that can they can use to assess the success of a treatment. And of course, we are still willing to go in this direction with new European project. In particular, we have a new project on a center of excellence for high-performance biomedical simulation that will start in October, in which hopefully we can go further, but there are other European projects that we hope to apply for to continue this work. So with this, I'd like, of course, to thank you for your attention and also to thank some of the people who have brought some material for this presentation. So people from UniG who produced the movie that you've seen, my colleague from Université Libre de Bruxelles, Karim Zouaoui and his team, the neurosurgeon from Montpellier, Omer Eckert, the team for image processing, which is Guy Courbebès and his team, and the team in University of Amsterdam, who did this fully resolved simulation where the red cells and platelets were actually simulated. Okay, thank you very much.